So, moving from Tennessee to New York had to be a pretty big culture shock and or change. Maybe not a shock, but a change. Talk to me a little bit about it.
I really eased into it. It would have been, you know, well, initially, you know, out of high school, I wanted to go to Berkeley.
Okay.
And I think that I would have gotten completely eaten alive. Because I didn't really start playing guitar until right before I started college. I wasn't like, you know, a experienced guitar player or anything like that, you know. And I wanted to go to Berkeley, but I wanted to go to school in Memphis, the University of Memphis, for a couple of years. And I transferred down to Florida, where they had a really great jazz program in Jacksonville. That's where I met a lot of the guys that I've worked with since then. From there, I went to grad school in Chicago. And Chicago's like the perfect midpoint between the South and New York City. It's okay. A big city, but it's still Midwestern, and it's got...
kind of a warm-up.
It's a warm-up. It really was. You know, but it got me accustomed to some things about city life that I had never done before. You know, taking subways and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, when I get to New York, it was a shock. I mean, I think everyone that comes to New York is shocked by the intensity of it. Everyone's sick for the first year. Your immune system gets completely ravaged. But you feel like you are you inject yourself into a jet stream, and it just takes you, you know. And that's why I couldn't imagine really living anywhere else, just because I really thrive off of that. And it's not just the music scene, because especially now, I don't go out to see music as much as I used to. But it's just being surrounded by people who are trying for something. And that's why I wanted to be there. That's why I continue to want to be there, is because it's so energizing for me.
How long do you think after you moved there, do you think you got control of that jet stream in any form or...
I don't know that anyone can control it. I mean, I think ultimately you have to sort of... The way I look at it is, you don't control the jet stream. You have to control yourself within it.
Okay.
And most people let it. It can take them down the wrong paths, you know, because it's very easy, because when you get so frustrated just being, especially if you live in Manhattan, as I did for the first few years, you know, you're just like, you're crammed in, people are constantly bumping into you, you're surrounded by crazy people, you're surrounded by incredibly gorgeous people, you're just, you know, incredibly rich people and incredibly poor people. And so you find yourself in this, you know, microcosm of everything that's good and bad about the world. And it can drive you insane. If you let it, you know, it can make you become a drug addict, it can make you become an anything addict, or it can shut you down. So you have to just be able to say, I'm in this, and I'm going to keep complete control of myself and the things that I can control around me, and let that energy sort of take me where it needs to go.
Right.
Because you can't control the jet stream, unless you're Bloomberg.
Doesn't he own the jet stream?
He owns the jet stream.
He does.
He licenses it, I think.
Right. One of your first majorly significant musical relationships was with Wynton Marsalis. Can you talk a little bit about how that came about, and then what kind of grew out of that?
Well, you know, for me, being in jazz school, particularly down in Jacksonville in the mid '90s, a bunch of people who went to that school wound up in the Lincoln Center program one way or the other, and we were all just fascinated by his music, you know. When we were all really into the music that he was making at that time, in the 90s, when he had his septet, and he was getting this Ellingtonian sort of longer form writing, and, you know, I was just really drawn to it, and, you know, it never had any guitar in it. But, you know, getting to know some of those guys like Reginald Veal and Ben Wolfe and Marcus Roberts, Marcus Printup, Wes Anderson, some of those guys, you know, I really started getting serious about wanting to be a part of what he's doing, and I got into writing. You know, I got into writing those kinds of pieces. And when I was for my senior recital down in Florida, I wrote this like hour-long suite, you know, for like five horns guitar. You know, and I played acoustic guitar, which is hilarious because like I used to go around to gigs with a guitar, an acoustic guitar with no pickup, and a microphone, a power amp, a Mackie board for the Phantom Power, and two Bose 802 cabinets so that I could play acoustically, you see.
Wow.
Okay. That's how, it was like this dogmatism thing of like, you know, if you plug in, it's going to completely, because that was the thing, you can't plug in the bass because it's going to ruin everything,
right.
You know. So that's kind of where I was at. And so I wrote this music, and Wynton came to Jacksonville, and I met him, and I sent him, he gave me his address, so I sent him the music. Shortly thereafter, I moved to Chicago to go to grad school, and one day Wynton called me. I put my phone number in there and everything. He called me, and he was very complimentary of the music, and he was like, I normally don't like the guitar. I don't really like jazz guitar. But I really love the way you write and all this kind of stuff. So then a few months later, they came through Chicago for his big epic slavery piece, Blood on the Fields.
Yep.
And then the night before that, two of his trombone players had a gig at this club in Chicago, and I went down and sat in. And Wynton goes up and plays his solo, and I'm standing off to the side. My friend Marcus Prinup, who was at that time in the Lincoln Center Band, still is, said, "You go out next." And there's all the guys from the Lincoln Center Band are on the gig. We're in this huge club, like, you know, those kind of clubs that don't even exist anymore.
Yeah.
Giant jazz club.
Yeah.
Playing a slow blues, no amplifier. I just walked into the microphone and played, you know. And I finished playing, and, you know, I was nervous, but I had a good time, and I went back, stood over by Wynton again. He was like, "Man, I don't like guitar players." And my heart just went, you know, I was pretty young at the time, and he was like, "But you can play." And I was like, "Yes!" So we just sort of, you know, kept in touch. And literally the day I moved to New York, I took my moving truck back to Midtown and called Wynton. And he said, "Come to the rehearsal the next day." So I did, and, you know, just started hanging out a little bit. And it was, he called me for a couple of things, little, you know, like kids' concerts and things like that. I kind of got involved a little bit. And then one night I went to the... back when they were still doing concerts at Avery Fisher and Alice Tully Hall at Lincoln Center, I went to see him do his piece called Big Train. Okay. And it was like this, you know, again, 90-minute long epic piece about trains, and I loved it. And I went home that night on the subway, and I was just so caught up by the music, and I loved it so much that I was literally just thinking to myself what I would do if I were going to play on this. Like, I would want to play on this music so right. much. And it didn't have a guitar part. There was no guitar in it whatsoever. But I really just let myself go there and just imagine, like, fantasize about playing that music.
Right.
And 2 months later, he called me to make that record. And it was, like, one of the most remarkable experiences. I was just like, did I make that happen? Did I, like, bend the jet stream? Maybe I did. Maybe you can control the jet stream. But, you know, I got to do that record. And, you know, he doesn't use guitar that much. But when he does, he usually calls me and... for some things, and it's you know, a couple of times a year I get to make music with him, and it's always fun, and it's always, you know, whatever the situation is, if I get to hear one trumpet solo by him, it's completely worth it. Because when you get to stand next to someone who is just one of the greatest musicians to ever pick up that instrument, or any instrument, and you just get to hear what the beauty that he can put out of his horn, it's such a pleasure. I will never get jaded about that. I will never not get excited like I did when I was a kid to hear him play his horn, because the sound is beautiful. His control of music and his ideas and his spirit are just, you know, it's unparalleled, you know, and I always love it.
Totally, totally. Since I've known of you and known you personally, mm-hmm. Your music has always been about vocals. Predominantly to me, like, yeah. That's what's always stuck out. Was yeah. that something that was there, you know, when you first moved to New York? Was that something that's developed over time?
No. I always loved to sing, and I always loved to write songs, but when I was I guess I was a freshman in college, my mom and I went to see Harry Connick play. It was great, you know, I enjoyed everything about it. It was when he was first sort of blowing up, and I remember being struck by what a remarkable piano player he was. And as I started getting into the sort of jazz thing a little more, people would kind of dog him out. Because he's a movie star, he's a singer. He's a right. singer, you know?
Right.
And it's like there was this sort of unspoken thing about vocalists. It's like, if you sing and also play an instrument, people would kind of not take you seriously. Which, when you think about it, if you look at the history of jazz music, everyone from Nat King Cole to, I mean, the god of them all, Louis Armstrong, I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Great singers, you know, and then lots of other people, you know, Fats Waller or whoever else. There's so many great musicians who sing and play an instrument. But I shied away from it because I wanted to be the, I mean, there's no way to say it. Like, I wanted to be the jazz guitar player of the moment. I wanted to be the guy that was playing jazz, that everyone was copying, that everyone wanted to hear, you know.
Right.
And when I got to New York, and I was singing, you know, various gigs, and you know, you can make money as a singer.
Yeah.
But when I got to New York, I realized pretty soon that the way that I like to play jazz had completely gone out of favor. You know, the sort of music that I really loved in terms of being a jazz musician was just not what people were hearing and what people were playing. Not to say that it was better or worse or anything, it was just a very different style of music. And so, you know, when I got to New York, I mean, the guy was Rosenwinkel, Kurt Rosenwinkel and his band. I mean, I used to go see them, and I was just like, wow, this guy, man, what a conception, what an amazing player. But he sort of defined that whole, he's the jazz guitarist of his generation, and mine, he's a few years older, but basically the same generation
right
now. And I was like, well, I don't play that way. I don't hear music that way. We're just, you know, so I can't really do what he does. And what I do is so, like, specific, I guess, in a way that it's not like you either have to sort of want that or like you just don't take, when I play jazz, you don't take that way of playing and just put it into everyone's gig because it just doesn't really fit.
Right.
You know, it's just not really, especially because for the longest time I was only playing acoustic guitar and most people were hearing electric with, you know, effects, which is odd now that I use them now and I play electric guitar. But I think more and more I just started seeing that, like, being a sideman all the time wasn't really for me because I like to write music. I like to, you know, I'm kind of a type A, you know, alpha dog kind of guy. So I like to be the guy that's sort of putting everything together.
Right.
And so I started just being more of a band leader and then started saying, you know what, I'm going to sing. And if someone doesn't take me seriously as a guitar player, well, that's fine. I can live with it. I don't care anymore. You know, I cared for so long what everyone else was going to think of, you know, how I played and, you know, am I going to impress? Because so much about New York is like cats just trying to impress each other.
Right.
You know, and I've never been, nor will I ever be, like the player's player, the guitarist, you know, which is awesome because I don't want people tripping over gig bags when they come to my gig. You know, it's like I want, you know, I want there to be women there.
Right.
So I just sort of kind of got a little bit out of that mentality and I started thinking a little broader and just thinking, well, yes, I've spent so much time learning and just delving into jazz music as seriously as you possibly can, but I like a lot of other music. You know, I grew up in Memphis. I grew up loving Al Green and Johnny Cash and Ray Charles and Elvis and
right.
all this other music that was, not to mention my grandfather, who's a he was a guitar player, not a professional, but he would just play, you know,